basically 600,000 postcards sold in the first quarter, over $5.5 million worth of sales from 27,000 different sellers. Now in this video, we're going to go over a special topic of Route 66 postcards. That's the famous historic road that goes across the country, Route 66. And I got some history on it because the road is there, but it's not there. It's historic now, but a lot of the things are still out there, and there's a ton of postcards. But we'll get into that after I do the what solds. I got 9 cards sold on eBay, and we'll go through those pretty quick and what people are buying. And then I got a poll. I've been looking at it this year, but I don't know if I'm going to do it. I thought I was going to do it, but have you ever sent a postcard in to be graded? And I got some different answers on the polls for this. Some people didn't know that that's a thing. And I'll show you a couple examples, but I don't think I'm going to do it. But still on the fence a little bit. We'll talk a little bit about graded postcards. And then viewer comments. I have only 2 comments. There's one about geographics of postcard collectors, a question. And then I got a longer one from a gentleman in the United Kingdom in an email. And he said to go ahead and talk about it on the video. And I replied to his question, and I think it sums up a lot of the stuff the way I think about promoted listings and getting the quantity of cards up. So I'll go ahead and read that longer email at the end. So always stick around at the end of the videos when I go over these viewer comments and my opinions. Then I had an epiphany. Flea market season starting up for me. Me and my father-in-law go out to the flea markets. And I have these little cards I usually print up and say, hey, I buy this, I buy that. And I wanted to do something different this year since I got that fancy printer. It does color, it's a laser printer. I said, I wonder what I can do with that. So I made up these cards here. I call them looking to buy cards. It's got my logo, looking to buy. I got postcards, photos, stereo views, trade cards, other ephemera. And then I have my contact information I'll put down here, my email address. Not my phone number on this one, I'll put it there. And it's also got a postcard back, so I can mail it to my family and friends if they're moving or have some stuff. But you say, well, you don't do a lot of photos or stereo views. I don't, but I know people that do. Like Neil, he does a lot of stereo views. I get a lot of those, I can sell them to Neil. Trade cards, photos. The Pittsburgh Picker do a lot of photos. If I come up with a good deal on them and I pass that deal along to the other resellers, maybe one day they'll pass something on to me. It's just how it works in the world. But I came up with this card and I printed it on the printer and I put my logo on there and everything and it came out pretty good. So I said, you know what, someone else might want these as well. So I offered them up in the Ko-Fi store because I also print out like the era cards here that people have gotten. The stamp box, how to read stamp boxes and the dates. Well, what if I put this out there and I can customize them for them? So if they purchase the cards, the prices are out there. It's not real high, but remember, if you're not a member at the $3 and $4 level in Ko-Fi, it's a premium price. It's whatever the price is. But if you're a member, you can get these things pretty cheap. And it's a good way to support this channel and also get something cool to hand out. So I put these out there. You can put your logo on there. I can put that on there for you, and you can have up to 6 things that you look for, and then your contact information. It's on semi-glossy paper and matted on the back with a postcard back. So I thought it would be something different, and I do it for myself, so I thought I would offer it out there. And as I've said before, I don't make a lot of money on Ko-Fi. It basically pays for itself, and it's just another neat place to find seller tools and do something different. If you don't want to print these up, you don't want to do that, just let me do it for you. Go over to the Ko-Fi store, and I'll put the link right here, and look for looking to buy cards. And it tells you the instructions. It's very simple. And you can buy 10 for $5 plus shipping, all the way up to a pack of 50. And I'll just print them out on this paper and ship them out to you. But let's get into what's sold. 9 cards. eBay has been up and down. I've heard so many different things going on. There's issues with the site, which I do agree. I seen a lot of errors the other day, things missing, it's not US. I don't see many of those much anymore, but it's just weird, the searches. Like when I go to set these videos up, it's taking me a little while sometimes to get the query right. I said, why am I getting these cards in there? So the search, I think, has got things, and I've just heard so many different things. stuff I can't control. So I'm just glad this year is cost-cutting year for me, because I think it's the right time. I kind of had a feeling with some stuff with the economy going on. That's another reason I did cost-cutting. Wasn't the main reason, but I'm glad I did it, because I'm working at a level I can support with the way eBay is acting right now in sales. And I don't think it's just eBay. I think other sites are slow as well. And with as many cards as I got up, and I'm still not selling, quantity rules in the average cards. It's not just me. So don't think it's you. There's other things out of your control that can cause this. But the first card I sold, just for $45, is San Diego State College. Just a chrome card of the State College. And it was posted in 1960. It's got some edge wear and stuff like that, but it's just a chrome card. $45. Next one is a Holiday Inn. Remember, I did that video on Holiday Inn cards. And there's one card in there that you want to look for. And I won't give you a spoiler if you haven't watched it. But watch that video. And every time I get a Holiday Inn card, I turn it over to see where it's at. Because there's one card that can demand a lot more money on there. But this is a Holiday Inn in Columbia, South Carolina. They got the picture going this way, but they got the names on there. It's got the great sign. This is called the great sign. And you'll hear about that in that video too. But this, someone had $2 on there. But I sold this $4 to $5. There's collectors for Holiday Inn postcards, so make sure you get Holiday Inn in the title. Next one is a pennant card. This is not a felt pennant. This is printed on there. And this is Honio. And this sold $5 to $6, I think more toward the $6 range. I consider these a little bit of a novelty card. Stuff 1915 posted. It's one of those divided back pennant cards. But so that's those pennant cards. And I always put pennant as the first postcard, pennant, and the town. That's about all I put in the title a lot. And I usually list them between $5 and $8, sometimes higher. This one I didn't find a lot for that one. This is Boynton Beach, Florida. Not sure where it's all at, but it's got a beach. $4 to $5. Some beaches do very well. A lot of beaches are just average, but I always throw the title into Worth Point or whatever to see what it is. Next one, this person bought three cards, and I just listed these. Less than 24 hours, these sold. This one sold for $7.65. This is Myrtle Beach Seahorse Court. Just the name and the sign alone, I knew I was going to price that card up. And this was posted in 1960. So he bought a motel, $7.65. Next one sold for $8.65. And this is Seaside Hotels in Myrtle Beach. Same gentleman, but what I think sold this car is the hotel. But look at those cars. Whole line of older cars from the 60s and the 50s and stuff. So that one sold for $8.65. And the next one he purchased was Hotel Walker. Wait till you see the back of this one. This is Hotel Walker. There's a sign. Not really a lot of action going on. And this was posted in 1957. But look at all the foxing and all the spots and staining. I did put in the description, staining on back. A lot of people don't care about the back as much as they care about the front. But $12.65. So three motel cards sold for $28.95. That was a good sale, because I basically have 8 cents into each one of these cards. So I got 24 cents into these, and I sold them for $29. So that's a good return. You don't get that every day, but those were not even in the store. All of those cards, less than 24 hours. Did I underprice them? I don't think so. I think this person had saved searches or looking for Myrtle Beach stuff. So I don't think I left too much on the table with those prices for motel cards in that price. But I think I did pretty well. So I was pretty happy yesterday with that one. Next one is in Campbell River, North Shore, Lake Superior. This is a white border card. Just like a waterfall. $4 to $5. I usually see that on a lot of white borders. This little writing there. It's not all of them, but I do see that a lot. So it's a white border. Remember, white border cards doesn't have that linen feel or that linen look. And just because they have a white border around it doesn't mean it's a white border card. The white, if you have one of these error cards, which I have to look at all the time, white borders are from 1915 to 1930 is the estimate. Some people get confused when they see a white border on a linen card and they think it's a white border. No, this is a white border. It's smoother. Sometimes you see that on there. and it doesn't have the linen look or the linen feel, that rough rag count on there. So that's a white border card for $45. Now this person sent me a message. Very rarely do I get messages and stuff like that that I really even watch in eBay. But I sent an offer. He missed the time frame and he wondered if he could still get the discount. I get that every once in a while, and I can tell you in seconds just by looking at the SKU number how old the card was and just by the picture of what it is. And he wanted to know if he can get the offer. I think it was $4.25 or something like that. So I just went and changed the price to the listing, and I sent him the link and said, yeah, I just changed the listing price. So Chrome, Two Bears in a Car, Clark's Trading Post. Been in my store a year or so. Heck yeah. Move it. Get it out. I don't have best offer turned on in my store. If I do have best offer anywhere, it's an oversight or just here and there. I don't play the offers. I give my best price up there. I don't list stuff and then do a 30% sale. I list my best price and I put it up there. If someone wants to send me a message and say, hey, will you take $3 for that? Sometimes I don't even look at them because my best price is up there and I'm competitive and I offer good service. I don't get into all the messages and looking at my phone all day long with offers and stuff like that. I usually look at messages in eBay. Just most of the time it's Tuesdays or Wednesdays. After a big weekend, a lot of people say, hey, my card says delivered, where is it? But I don't get that much anymore either. So I'll just real quick look down and then just, I don't deal with it. And it's just part of the thing I do. I don't think I'm dissing my customers or anything, but when people send, hey, will you take $2 for this card? You don't have to reply to every message is my thinking. And you don't have to have the last word. I've seen people say, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, and just keep it going. They're not my friends. It's a transaction. They purchased something, they gave you cash, they expect an item. End of deal. Even if it says repeat customer, I do have some repeat customers that'll send me questions, and I do watch for Alan from the UK. He's bought enough boat cards, photos from me every week. I'll jump on stuff like that. Repeat buyers, if they buy two cards, they're a repeat buyer. But followers is what you want in your store, I think. Followers. Because those are the people that are kind of like dedicated to your place. They're watching your stuff. They're getting your newsletters from eBay. And they're doing all that. So that's what I kind of go after more than anything is on there. All those other numbers I don't mess with. And I'm not going to do the flea market stuff all day long about offers. Some people do. I don't have anything against it if you do, if that's your model. It's just that I don't want to be on my phone all day, you know, sending offers. But if one comes through and I do see it and it catches my eye and I see the SKU number and it's been in there for a year and a half, I might accept it. But very rarely do I look at those on there. But that's what sold. Total was 9 cards, $56.11. And my average sale price was $6.23. So it's still going up. I'm below my 14 for today, and I'm below 70. But I think the other day I had a $180 day or something, and I was high up there. So for the month of there, I think I'm about 15 cards. But for the year, I'm still at 13, so I'm one away. I am above $70 a day for sure on there, and my ASP is going up. So my three key indicators this year I wanted to work on there. And my expenses are way down. I've cut so much out, and I didn't hurt anything, any quality, quantity, stuff like that on there. I was able to find over $3,000 in savings this year and not hurt my model or my sales. But that's what sold. Now let's get into Route 66. I wanted to do this because I wanted to dig deeper. Remember, I know a little about a lot, but every time I do a video, I dig deeper and get facts and look at a little deeper on the subject. And that's what you should do with these videos. Down at the bottom is chapters. So you can watch this video today, and maybe 6 months down the road, you're looking at a box of cards, and it has a lot of Route 66. And you get those, and you say, I need to learn a little bit. Go back to this video, go down into chapters down here, find the special topic, and watch the 10 minutes I talk about Route 66. It might help you with that. And that's what I've had to do with a couple of my videos. I got some cards, and I said, I remember talking about those. But I didn't remember everything. So I would go back and watch myself on the special topic and say, oh, okay, that's what it was. Or I'll bring up the document that I read from and look at that as well. Just, you can't remember everything. You can't do everything. It's just so much. There's so much about postcards and reselling. You got to be like a sponge, but you can't absorb everything. You got to take pieces. And that's what the Route 66 did for me here. You'll see a couple cards here that I've talked about, and now I know why they're special. It reminded me of some things. But while I go through some facts about Route 66, I'm going to show you some postcards I found about it. So U.S. Route 66 or U.S. Highway 66, U.S. 66 or Route 66. So you'll hear both things. Was one of the original highways in the United States numbered highway system. It was established on November 11, 1926, with road signs erected the following year. So they got the road, but there was no signs until the next year. The highway became one of the most famous roads in the United States. I think everybody has heard of Route 66. It was recognized in the popular culture by both the 1946 hit song, Get Your Kicks on Route 66. That's the slogan, Get Your Kicks on Route 66. And the Route 66 television series. Now, I don't remember that. But I got it written down to go look and see what that was, because it just sparked. It's not a priority, but I wanted to go see if I can find something on YouTube or what on Route 66 television series, which aired on CBS from 1960 to 1964. So it's before my time, a few years. It took a number of years for it to be fully paved, so it must have been a dirt gravel road there for a while. Not till the early 30s. It was established in 1926 and not fully paved until like the early 30s. Wow. And I don't think they had the good tires like we do today. The starting point for Route 66 used to be the intersection of Jackson Boulevard and Michigan Avenue in Chicago. And I know where that is. This road was made one way in 1955, so the begin sign is now at the corner of Adams and Michigan Avenue in Chicago, so they moved that. The midpoint lies around Adrian, Texas. The endpoint of the route is the intersection of Ocean Avenue and Lincoln Boulevard in Santa Monica, California. And I showed a little map here too to give you the idea of how it crosses the nation. Route 66 passes through 8 states: Illinois, Missouri, Kansas, Oklahoma, Texas, New Mexico, Arizona, and California. Route 66 is only about 30 to 40 minutes west of me, and I've actually driven down some of that. One of my friends owns an antique mall right on Route 66, and it's called Route 66 Antiques in the town of Wilmington. I've watched him grow that business. The road passes through 3 time zones: Central, Mountain, and Pacific. That makes sense. The introduction of interstate highways in the 1950s eventually led to the demise of Route 66. The Route 66 was officially decommissioned in 1985. That's about 40 years ago, after it was entirely replaced by segments of the interstate highway system. There is parts of the road that I know I've walked down or rode my bike on or driven on that are off the main highway, and it's still there, but it's kind of blocked off. You can drive for a little bit just for a historical thing in this one town west of me, but I've walked down a couple miles down the old Route 66. The pavement's still there. The first Route 66 associations were founded in Arizona in 1987 and Missouri in 1989, incorporated in 1990. Other groups in the other U.S. 66 states soon followed. So there's organizations and associations that were created for the historical purposes. In 1990, the state of Missouri declared U.S. 66 in that state a historic route. So there's a lot of history around Route 66. A lot of iconic places. Gas pumps, restaurants, just a lot of stuff. People traveled in those days and stuff like that. Dirt roads, the paved roads. So there's a lot of history, and these associations are really driving it through. And there's a lot of postcards, as you saw. Now, what's the sell-through rate? Remember, sell-through rate is sold divided by listed times 100, gives you a percent. And that's the number of cards moving through the eBay system. So I put out there, postcard Route 66, and I found 1,500 sold with 6,900 listed times 100 gives you a 22% sell-through rate. That's up with McDonald's, Disney, and WeakyWatchy. So some of these cards are passing through the system pretty quick through eBay. Now, if I bump them up against other things, like stadiums, 14%, maps, 10%, motels are 6%, and turnpikes, which is another road, 4%. It's still up there by 8%. So Route 66, I think some of the older cards, some of the newer sets and stuff like that do pretty good, but if you get some Route 66 stuff, you wanna, I would vet those out just like I said about the other things. So 22% sell-through rate. It's not a bad sell-through rate when everything else is 14 and below. The average is usually 4 to 5 to 6 around there, and this is 22. So this is a higher sell-through rate card. So if you see a white box and it's full of 20% churches, postcards and stuff, and then 50% has Route 66 collection in there, you know you can turn those a little bit faster, and the church cards and stuff are gonna sit, you will pay up a little bit for the Route 66. That's what these sell-through rates do for me, is stuff like that, is when I'm looking in there, it reminds me that, hey, yeah, Route 66 is not a bad sell-through rate. Doesn't mean they are gonna sell. It just means you got a better chance, and you're making an educated guess with data, not just how you feel. How many times have you walked up to a box or a basket of cards and you're just sitting there looking, oh, that looks cool, that looks cool, and you have no idea if it sells or not? Watch the videos. There's over 180 videos now I've done, and I have that sheet on Ko-Fi for sell-through rates. All that stuff, you'll never remember everything, but it just puts a little bit in your mind to say, Route 66, Mark said something about that. That's not a bad card. QSL cards suck. Don't buy those. Unless you want to sell them in lots or they're really ornate. So that's what it helps you with. And if it just helps you one time, then that's what it is. So not bad sell-through rate. Now what about some really high cards? The RPPCs I've been putting in here. I found these two. And I picked them out. And I think they're both RPPCs. One says it and the other doesn't. And looking from a flat picture and what I know, it does look like that one, and they're both auctions. But this one here, Route 66, vintage Route 66 postcard, Hal Liner's Cafe and Cabins. So along Route 66, there was a lot of stops, a lot of wayside places, towns popped up, and stuff like that. And that's where you'll get these iconic places, or people traveled there, or their family took a trip. And if it was done in 1926, a lot of those people maybe are nostalgic about it, but their kids might have went with them, and they're going to be my age or whatever. $201.50 with 9 bids and free shipping. Heck yeah, I'd give free shipping on that card. But that looks like an RPPC. You want to take Helen's Cafe and put it into eBay, WorthPoint, Google to see what's out there. And this, I think they did a very good job of putting this out on auction and got $200 for a card. An RPPC of Cajun Pass, Route 66, Gas and Auto Court, San Bernardino, Colorado, near Victorville. A lot of keywords in there. $111 with $4 shipping. Not bad. There is some higher priced ones out there. There's light at the end of the tunnel for postcards. And that's why I started putting these higher ones in there instead of just throwing them out. So there's two cards right there over $300. And what do you think they paid for them? Probably found them in a lot. Then we get in back into the average stuff that you're going to see every day. And here's the sold high. Now, if you're not subscribed, make sure you subscribe, because on the community tab, I've been sending out things. And this card, the top card here, is the Wigwam Village. And that's on Route 66. Those cards have always done well for me. They're not $200 and stuff, unless they're probably RPPCs or something. They could be up higher. But like this card here, I've sold many times, Wigwam Village. And I put that on the community tab just to get that to go out on YouTube. And if you're subscribed, you'll see that pop up in your home screen, and it'll just give you an idea. Nothing you have to do, just say, hey, watch for these cards. And Wigwam here was one of them. This one sold for $35, plus $5 shipping, so $40 for that linen. It looks like that's a linen card, I'm pretty sure. I've sold it before. There's Wigwam Village number 6. There's numbers on these. If I remember right, $35 for Wigwam Village. Write it down. Next one is the Arcadia, Postcard Arcadia, the Frontier Drive-In Restaurant, Car Hop. Car Hop's drive-ins, all associated with Route 66, $23, $5 shipping. So they got $25. Took a best offer. Look at that. Linen card, Route 66, $25. Next one is a 1950s Tulsa, Oklahoma postcard, Oasis Motel, Highway Route 66. Like I said, motels and stuff like that, $24. In auction, 7 bids, free shipping. So $24. Those are the high ones. Now, we just went through those in less than 5 minutes. And then these other people here are selling them low. So this one was Gallup, New Mexico, Route 66, roadside postcard. Thunderbird Lodge, 1950s, $240. And we just saw another card sell for more. Do you think they could get a little bit more? I think so. I think they could do a little bit better and get some more money in their pocket for that. Next one is Route 66, El Rancho Hotel, Gallup, another one, 1970s, $1.99. And then, here's Sleep at Wigwam. Just talked about Wigwam, it sold for $35, and here's one for $1.99. Route 66 card, modern postcard. It might be modern, but it's still Wigwam. People have a collection thing. Hey, I just sold a postcard, let's see what I sold. Postcard, Ocean Forest Hotel, Myrtle Beach, South Carolina, from the Nashville Hall, $465. So at least I got one sale today so far. But Wigwam Village, I don't care if they're new or old, I would definitely take a deeper dive into those. And I would price them up no matter what, if they're new or old. They've always done well for me. I gravitate to those when I see them. And they're easy to pick out because they got the teepees and they say Wigwam. But that's the sold high and sold lows. Now let's see what these people are listed. These aren't bad. These are not really high ones. There were some other ones I threw out that were just off in left field. But here, the people are not, they're testing the market a little bit. Here's one for a deluxe court roadside motel, $54. It's from Canada. Route 66 doesn't go through Canada, but people could know about it. Is it out of line? I didn't do a lot of research. I think it's a little high. If they wanted to sell, I would probably bring it down a little bit, but there could be something there and it could be low. You have to vet these out. And then you get the Terminal Motel 66, Illinois. That's a multi-view. We saw those other ones selling $20. That's a chrome card. The linens seem to do better with Route 66, the older ones. It might sell. And then the bottom one. I would probably say it's close to being right. I would probably be up there too. It's got that gas sign and the signs in there. It's a linen, it's got the sky, it's got the building. I'd vet it out, but I don't think they're far off, or they got best offer on there. So these aren't bad. I think that you just got, when you do stuff like this, you put them up high, you have to watch them. Because if they don't sell after a while, you might want to bring them down a little bit and it'll trigger. If you go, I think that's under 5%, I heard. I don't quote me on this, but I think if you drop it 5%, it sends a message to the watchers that, hey, I dropped 5%. Then you get in the listed low, $225, $1.99, and $299. I think the bottom one might be a newer card, but look at that. There's two watchers on there, and it looks like they had a lot of these because the last one. But $299, if you've sold those and you got two watchers, no wonder you got watchers, because it's $299, free shipping. There's nothing left, as we saw in the hospital video with the calculator. Route 66, I don't think there's too many cards that I would sell at that level. I wouldn't sell any of them at all in my store. It's $465 and above. But these people, not much you can do. It's just people put it out there and stuff. But I think, hopefully, some people see this and know that they can raise their prices and people will buy them. They might settle a little longer, but at least you'll make some money for the time. That's Route 66. When you get those motels and stuff, if it says Route 66 on there, make sure you get that in the title. There is collectors and there is a big market for Route 66. I see that with the town where my friend has his antique store. They're right down the street's another Route 66, Route 66 restaurant, Route 66 gas station, because the Route 66 goes right through that town. And so every town all the way from here to California has places like that. And another town down the road has those retro looking restaurants. One has a big Gemini astronaut with a helmet on and I'm holding a rocket. The Gemini restaurant, it's changed hands a few times. There's so much iconic stuff on there. One of the trips I got planned, I don't know if I'll get to it, is I wanted to drive down Route 66 as far as I can go in 5 days looking for postcards. Take pictures of everything. Me and my wife, we just get in the car and just drive. And just stop wherever we stop, eat wherever we eat, and see if we can find any postcards in antique stores and stuff like that. And so I think it'll be a pretty neat trip. Hopefully we can do it one day. That's Route 66. Get your kicks. Who knew? Now we're going to get into the poll. I know nothing about grading postcards or sports cards and stuff like that, so I've been trying to educate myself. Not making it a priority to do and stuff like that, but I had it as a goal this year is to maybe send one in. I don't think I'm going to do it. I just don't have any cards that are really worth that. And after looking at some of the prices to do it, I mean, my God, it's expensive. But the poll I put out was, have you ever sent a postcard in to be graded? And this helped me make my decision too. 3% said yes, 97% said no. And some of the comments, remember, I just pull these random comments. I look for the subject and stuff, but if I get 10 comments, I might pull three. And I just randomly do it. So Chris said, I think if I find some valuable Halloween ones, I would send those out to get graded if they are in decent condition. I would say, yeah, I agree, Chris. I mean, I've seen some cards like that graded out there. But yeah, it has to be very special to pay for the cost of it and you're going to get a return on it and stuff. Or if you're going to keep it as well. But thanks, Chris. And then Three Wheeler actually sent me a message and I asked him to send me the postcard. And while I read this, I'm going to show it to you. Three Wheeler said, most anything nowadays is gradable. True. Whether or not the grading company will actually give the item a grade is another story. I would probably say so. I do have an Alan Clapsaddle St. Patrick's Day postcard, which you're seeing right now, because I asked him if he would send it to me and I could share it on a video, and he agreed, and he okayed that. It's an Alan Clapsaddle, and you can see that written at the bottom. St. Patrick's Day postcard that would be even better graded, a gem, mint 10, and a nice acrylic nuclear blast-proof protector slab inside a sleeve. So that's one card he thinks he would want to send in and do that. But look at that. It's got Alan Clapsaddle. It's got the pipe on there. It's got that nice green in there. You see the four-leaf clover. So I love St. Patrick's card, but every time I go to bid on them or pick them up, they just go so high. There's nothing left for me to sell them for. But this is a really nice card. And thanks, Three Wheeler, to share. But if any of you guys have any cards you want me to share on the videos, that's one thing I'm looking to do a little bit more. Is showing off other people's collections, like cards like this that I can show, just so people can look at it. But thanks, Three Wheeler. Then John's Mini Collections. I have graded a few postcard back baseball cards, but not sure they actually count as postcards. A 1926-29 Jimmy Fox in an SGC2 went for $2,500, and a Bay Roof from the same set and a PSA 2 sold for $8,500. Outside of sports crossovers, it doesn't make sense to me, though. Yeah, I agree. And I had one other comment. People said, I didn't even know it was a thing. People said, what grading companies do it? If you go out on eBay, you can type in postcard space graded, and you'll see some of them in the slabs, like the Goofy series, and there's a Mickey Mantle Holiday Inn out there. And so like that, then there'll be some sports cards that have the postcard back, like he said here. But I don't think it's something I want to get at. I don't sell it that higher level cards, but I wanted to see the process, and after looking at it and the money that would be spent and stuff, I still don't think I'll do it unless, like Chris said, or John said, the baseball ones with the postcard or a very unique, hard to find one. Like that Santa card that I sold last year for $1,900, if it didn't sell, I could send that in and be graded. But I still got $1,900 for it. How much more would I have got? That's the question. If you have sent something graded, let me know in a comment to this video here, or the poll. You'll see the polls out there. They're all out there. I don't take them down. They're out there. Let me know if you've done well with that or not. But I don't think I'm going to do it this year. That's the poll. Now, viewer comments. I got two comments today because the next one after this is kind of long, and it came from a gentleman in the UK. But first, Susie Tribble asked a good question here, and I really don't know the answer because I don't know everybody on there. But I did bring up some geographics of my YouTube channel. I have data. I don't want to speculate out there, but I can a little bit. But you know me, I like data. But Susie said, thank you for another informative video. You're welcome. Question, who collects postcards and why? I have been selling postcards for a few months on a small scale. And I am amazed how many men I mail postcards out to. I was wondering if you have any insight into the gender or age of collectors. Thank you. Postcard collecting is one of the top three things in the States. There's stamps, coins, and postcards. It's Deltiology is the name of collecting and studying the postcards. So if you do that, you're a Deltiologist, is what they call you. It's been around for over 100 years. People back in the early 1900s, that was their way of looking and seeing places, is postcards. Mom would sit down at the fire and talk about postcards or in there and stuff like that. Golden age of postcards, there was billions of in that time period. They say about 4 billion, but they really don't know, because people to save on postage would put 3, 4, 5 postcards in a letter. So they really don't know. So that it's on top, billions and billions of postcards were printed and sold and mailed during that time. So I really don't know. I've seen women, I've seen men. But I said, you know what I do have is who YouTube gives me this information behind the scenes, and it gives you a little insight what I see in YouTube studio for the channel. And I didn't think it was anything personal to anybody, but here's the age of people that watch my videos. So 5.4% are 35 to 44. There's nobody really before 35 years old. Then 45 to 54 is 16.4%. And then the biggest one is 55 to 64. And that's where I've fallen with my age. And then 65 plus years, 37.4%. So basically people over 45 and older are ones that I've been looking at, and that we want to call the baby boomers who we are. I'm right on the last year of the baby boomer era in the 60s, mid-60s. So that's my geographic deal. Another one I had that I didn't put up here is it's majority are male. And there is, I would say, less than a quarter are female that watch the channel. So it's male that watch the channel. So I hope that's helping you. But I also found this other, I don't look at the analytics as deep as some other people do on YouTube. But I saw this and I said, wow, that's different. The people that watch the channel that are subscribed is 51%. And then there's people that are not subscribed to the channel, 48%. So a 50-50 split. So if you're not subscribed, hit the little subscribe button. It's free. It helps the channel. It turns things on. It gets more people watching and stuff like that. But that was, I just wanted to show you some of the analytics that they give me. And I haven't looked at this in so long. I said, wow, that's a 50-50 split. Got to get more subscribed. I hope that helped you, Susie, and everyone else on demographics of what I see, data I have. But if anybody else has any other statistics out there, please leave it in the comments to me, and I'll see if I can share it. So, but that gives you a little insight on who watches the channel. Now this next question. This came in an email from Old Postcards from the United Kingdom, England, around that area. And he said I can talk about this on the video, and I wanted to because it was a question that covers a few things and some of my opinions. Message was, hi Mark, I have your email address as you kindly offered me advice on using a duplex scanner, which I have had over a year, and I bought after watching your video on how to use it. Best thing I ever did. Absolutely. I hear that all the time about scanners and thermal printers. Why didn't I do it before? Is what I hear. And he goes on, I hope you don't mind me emailing. Not at all. That is a separate inbox from my personal. It's contact@smpostcards.com, and I see those totally separate, and I try to reply to all of them. If you ever send me a message or a comment I don't reply, send it again. I might have missed it somehow, but I try to reply to everything. So just hit me up on email or put a comment in. I'll try to get to it. I'm pretty good at it. And if I missed it, it's just an oversight. He said, I hope you don't mind me emailing, but I just watched your eBay listings video on YouTube and like all your videos. Thank you. He really enjoyed it. One thing I wondered though, and have never heard you mention, do you bother using promoted listings? I only have about 650 listings at the moment on eBay UK. I am based here in England, as I have about 4,000 on my own website, but there is no getting away from the fact that eBay provides a better footfall. But when I look lately at my visitor counts on eBay, they are like one or two, so many are zero views. And we'll get into that in a second. I promote some, but only a small portion that I feel eBay should be showing listings to people without paying extra for it. But it made me wonder what sellers like yourself do, or with you having thousands of cards listed as opposed to a few hundred, does this make up for it and bring more views without using promoted listings? By all means, use this question on YouTube in the future if you wish to, but I would love to hear your views on it. Take care. Keep up the good work. He's got a bunch of different things here, and I think I answered his question. I'm going to read my response here in a second. Now, one of the things I don't talk about a lot is promoted. I'm not against using it. I think everything eBay gives us is another tool to use. It's a race to the top or bottom in some areas. You'll see here in the message here in a second. The way I use it, I just don't talk about it a lot because it's just not a thing I do, like best offer. My model doesn't have that. Now, there's nothing wrong with it if that's your model and stuff, but I found success so far without using a lot of the tools and stuff like that I use them to a limit on there. I'm not against it, but I want to build an organic business, based store. I don't want to have to do all these other things to get people coming in and put flashy signs up and promotions and all, and keep massaging that store like that. I want to see what my organic is. And that's a long haul. It takes time. But I'm in a position where I can do that. But here's my reply. Another long one I'll put up on the screen. Thanks for watching, and glad the scanner is working out, is what I said. I'm very selective on using promoted listings. I do it more to get people to see a card and possibly come and follow my eBay store. I think followers is a big thing because those are the people dedicated to your store. To me, this is what I think about postcards. To me, average cards equals quantity. And I think Popeye, I've heard him say a lot, the more you list, the more you sell. So quantity for average cards, average sell-through rates, average cards, not your hard-to-find ones and stuff like that, it's you gotta have quantity, and you're gonna see some statistics here in a minute why I think that way. And I think hard to find cards, etc., the rare ones, the hard to find, the RPPCs, I think they sell themselves. You put the right title in there and get the right price, I think they sell themselves. They're different than your average cards, but average is quantity. If I did not have the quantity I have listed, I would probably adjust my prices to use promoted listings more to help get them in front of people. So if I didn't have 42,000 plus listings up, promoted listings might be on the table a little bit more. But I would have to adjust my price on there. I also feel the cost of promoting the listing fee has to be passed through to the buyer in the price. A lot of people promote their list their items way up and just absorb the cost, which to me is not a good business model in the long run. Someone told me that free is not good. Everything you do with that postcard, your time, what it costs you to do it, your mailings and stuff, all those are costs of that product to be put together and sold by you. You need to pass those costs on. If the post office raises rates, those rates need to be passed on. If you feel you can absorb it because you're doing great sales, you can do that. But in the long run, can you absorb every postage increase? So you got to see what it costs. At $4.65 for an average car I buy for less than a nickel, I make money. If I sell it less than that, my margin goes down. Sometimes I just sell it to get rid of it because I'll take the money, get my nickel back, and do something. But I think people doing 12, 15%, whatever, you know, 10 above trending promoted, those are costs coming off the bottom line that you could have had. But if they're not selling, and you adjust your price too high, it won't sell. It's a teeter-totter thing. But if I didn't have the quantity I had, I think promoted might be on the table a little bit more. Also, postcards is a very saturated market on eBay. At any one time, there are 7 to 10 million postcards listed on eBay. I've seen that number go between there a lot. That's a lot of listings, and a lot of the same cards. Just to give you some stats here, From January 1st to March 31st of this year, there were 595,561 postcards sold on eBay with a total sales of $5.5 million. All this from 27,360 different sellers. So you're looking 7 to 9 million postcards on eBay listings, basically 600,000 postcards sold in the first quarter, over $5.5 million worth of sales from 27,000 different sellers. You're talking about being a minnow in a big fish pond. That's the way I think. I'm even with the quantity I have, I'm still a small fish out there. There's just so much. And to turn that boat, a lot of people think small. They think very small. They think they're a brick and mortar, and then make one change, everybody's going to see it. eBay's not going to show every card. They can't. To everybody, you're going to be on the front page, bottom page, whatever. But if people are following your store, you've directed them into your store. They're not looking at all the 7 million. They're just looking at the 42,000 I got in there, and they can shop my store in there. That's why I think followers, categories, so they can shop that store easily and stay there. You don't want them looking at those other, 9 million cards out there from those 27,000 sellers. And then I go on and I said, unless you have some very hard to find cards or have built a good number of store followers, it is a long game. Maybe niching down, here's a suggestion I gave them, and I've said this before to people. Maybe niching down to a certain type of card would help. The reason I say this, as you have seen, I have sell a lot of naval ship postcards, as I have thousands of them, and they are all priced to sell. I price them to sell. I got them for a very good price. Maybe, for example, you could start focusing on RPPC postcards and just list a ton of those with good prices and become very good at researching them. Kind of have to find a way to stand out from the crowded field out there. Hope this helps and I answered some of your question, Mark. So basically, with 650 cards, it's a tough nut to crack. You got to stand out. Me with 42,000 plus listings, I still have to stand out. I just can't put all Niagara Falls and Grand Canyon postcards up. No one's going to sit there and look at that all day long. Now, I do sell some of those, but not as much as I sell Route 66 or hospital cards or ships, naval ships, stuff like that. So you got to have a good mixture, I think, a good linens, chromes, divided back. So I'm divided back down to chrome and current. That's my niche. Now, like I just said, that's my niche. And one of my main categories is naval ships because I bought that big collection a couple years ago. So I get a lot of sales from those naval ships. And a lot of those come from Google. People will go out there and Google their boat and points them in there. So as you see on the videos, I sell ships all the time. I don't think I hit a ship today, though. It might be a first time. But I got thousands of them. And I got less than a penny in these. They gave me a great deal. They're just happy that the ships are out there. So I kind of niched down. So if you're all over the board and you got all these different cards, see if you can find one of these in one of these videos that you can look and niche down on. Example was real photo postcards. If you get really good at that, and really, there's some money out there. Maybe that's what you want to do. Maybe you're not a big lister and you don't want to list 50 to 100 cards a day. You want to research. You want to go through five, maybe list five cards a day and really get down into the genealogy of the cards. And then you can sell it for $60 because you got more information. A lot of people are like that. I'm a bulk lister. I'm a quantity person. I'm not a big researcher. I'll sell my cards if somebody can do that. People are wired differently and like to do things. You do what you like, you'll be successful. You have a better chance. If you're not a quantity person, try to find a niche. Maybe it's all Route 66 and you own Route 66. A lot of people get upset when they buy a collection and they got a whole bunch of one type of card, one area. I love that because I own that. Just like Merry Widow hats. There's only 192 of those listed. I think I just put 25 of those up. If I see them again, I'm just going to keep adding to it. Yeah, they don't sell that often, that much. But anybody looking for Merry Widow, they're going to come to me. Cars. Route 66, if you can get a ton of those up. Just a niche. I think that's where it needs to be. If you're, the more you list, the more you sell. I think quantity, average cards, quantity rules, your hard to find, rare, RPPC and stuff, I think they sell themselves. The more research you do, the more money you get out of it. So I hope that helped some people with that and my thinking. And if you do send me an email, these are the type of replies I try to give. Thanks for watching. I'll catch you in the next one. And here's a few fishies to watch. Bye.